Pretty good weekend at the theaters.
Not too shabby, not too shabby. We'll see.
Well, stay tuned for our reviews and more. Last week we had 7 new releases. This week we only had 4 that released
Four.
in Fayetteville.
Yeah, it's starting to go down, pare down to next week may only have three, so we'll see. We'll see if we can keep that streak of bringing it down.
First review we have for you is Max Payne.
There's an army of bodies under this river. Criminals reaching up to welcome me as one of their own. It was an easy mistake to make.
The devil is building his army. Max Payne.
He's looking for something that God wants to stay hidden.
All right, Max Payne, starring Marky Mark and the Funky Bun. Oh, wait, sorry, Mark Wahlberg, based on a video game, a very popular video game that I've never played, so maybe that's why this story was so muddled to me. Because it's Mark Wahlberg plays a cop that is trying to investigate how his family gets murdered, and he's really bitter, you know, like you would expect a cop that got his family murdered to be. And there's all this stuff going on with these people taking this weird blue liquid, which turns out to be Valcar. And this movie's really kind of a confusing, surreal, kind of boring action flick that doesn't really go anywhere and gets really confusing. There's not really anything in this that you would, I think, is memorable other than, okay, nothing memorable than maybe some weird demons that you've seen 100 times.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you on this. It's pretty much just all the boring video game tropes that you've seen if you've played even one first-person shooter video game before, and they put it on the screen. It just doesn't work at all. The whole movie is just made up of horribly written cutscenes. And you know, I don't demand a lot of realism from action movies. I don't care if you get 8 shots off from a 6-shooter, but when you get like 200 shots off, then I'm kind of
I
skeptical.
gotta say, it does not bother me.
And
When I'm watching a movie that's based on a video game, I do not care if they're shooting 500 shots in like an old Civil War single shot or American Revolution single shot musket. I don't care. It's a fantasy. It's a fantasy.
I mean, just the whole, I mean, like you said, the whole plot is just boring and confusing. You have characters in
This movie
the
would have
movie
been
that show
worse.
up for like one scene and then they disappear and you
Can
never
you
hear from
imagine
them
if they
again.
had to reload in this movie would be worse. This would be more boring than like, oh, let's stop the
Hey.
action, the little bit of action we got here, and let's reload.
Right, I mean, like I said, the whole, it's all cutscene. You have hardly any actual shooting. Like,
Yeah,
I think
it's
it was a good 45 minutes before you see the first, I mean, I guess there's one scene in the subway, but you don't get see a first actual shootout until about 45 minutes into the
Yeah,
show.
it's. I mean, it's a video game movie. It's got or a music video game where it's just like tons of shots. You know, there's nothing, there's no sweeping shots, and there's no great cinematography. There's some cool, you know, effects,
I did
color
like the color
effects.
effects.
Yeah,
Yeah,
there were some cool
mostly
color
blue
effects.
turns to red. I like that a lot. I mean, the slow motion snow we've seen a lot of times before, but I still liked
And
it.
those crazy demon angels things, and when they did the fire and stuff, it was
It was all right.
visually, you know,
I just
nice.
think
I don't
that, you
know,
know,
it's hard to be nice to
nine
it.
years after The Matrix, you should be able to do bullet time really well instead of
No.
just passively well.
No, they still don't got it. But like Eagle Eye, this is my TNT classic of the week. You watch TNT, you might stick on it. Now, one thing that did that we
Nobody
talked
watches
about, Mila
TNT
Kunis,
though.
what was going on with her character? I guess we
She's,
have no idea,
I don't know,
unless
like,
you research it,
I
right?
thought that at first she was some sort of madam or maybe a drug dealer, and then I got on Wikipedia and found out that she's supposed to be a professional assassin, which explains where all these guns are coming from.
Yeah.
But I don't, she's trying to break out of the 70s show role that she's had. She was in Forgetting Sarah
She was
Marshall.
great Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
Yeah, it's still too hard for me to not think, like the whole, every scene she had, I kept expecting the camera to pan to the right and have somebody else say something. It was just too, she wasn't believable in that role for me at all.
Yeah, I would have preferred that she didn't take this role and just stepped with Forgetting Sarah Marshall, because this is a step down from her role.
She's a lot better in comedy. She's not very, she doesn't have an intimidating face.
It's good.
That's just,
It's good to see that
some
Jeff
people just can't
Bridges'
do it.
younger, less unsuccessful brother Beau Bridges is getting work though in this. So that's good to
Yeah,
see.
I'm not sure how great to see that is. I mean, pretty much I guess if you have to see every action movie that's out, go see it.
It's okay. I mean, it's got some nice visuals, but it's not even a great action movie.
Yeah, I would say definitely skip it. Go play the video game instead.
If you're a fan of Ludacris was in this.
Yeah, you know, and I guess he did an all right job. I'm not really sure why his character was in this movie now that I think about it.
Maybe in the video game you would know more. But moving on to our next movie.
Fortunately, this Max Payne was the worst of the weekend, so The Secret Life of Bees set the bar a little bit higher.
Don't go getting your hopes up, all right?
They got nowhere else to go.
All right, The Secret Life of Bees. It follows the story of a girl in 1964 who runs away from home, befriended by an African-American family, and it really deals with civil rights issues. And I thought a pretty good way. It has Dakota Fanning, Jennifer Hudson, both of them you saw there, Queen Latifah, Alicia Keys in this movie. And I don't want to describe the plot too much for you because some of it does hinge around a little bit of a mystery. And this, when I really thought about it, the movie should have been pretty awful. It has a sappy plot. It's supposed to be a tearjerker. But what really set this movie above all the bad movies that I've trashed throughout the years is the acting. The acting in this is fantastic. I mean, all these characters, as characters, weren't that great, but they're just pushed to their complete potential. Dakota Fanning plays a slightly older role than she has in the past, and she does a really great job in this. The reviews from Hound Dog, you know, the infamous Dakota Fanning rape movie, have been pretty bad, so I was glad to see that she made a good showing in this. And I think that as the years go by, she could turn out to be the fantastic actress that a lot of people have been saying. And not very many child actors and actresses end up having a decent career once they hit their teenage years. So I see a lot of great potential for her.
Yeah, I didn't see it, but when I heard Alicia Keys, Queen Latifah, Jennifer Hudson, I say it sounds like a great remake for Moulin Rouge. A great chance to do a Moulin Rouge kind of video for Secret Life
of
Bees.
Not quite.
There's no Moulin Rouge moment in this?
No.
No,
I mean, the story's pretty serious. It's based on a novel that I haven't read, but everyone I've talked to that's read it apparently loved. And it deals with some very serious themes. And I'm pretty skeptical about most of these civil rights movies because a lot of them, like The Express, which I haven't seen, but all these football movies, they'll have a horrible plot and then they throw in this moral role so people will feel obligated to like it. So going into this sort of film, I have a bias against it. So the fact that I enjoyed it says something about the acting and how they dealt with these issues.
Well, that's interesting. I only saw the preview. I didn't see the movie, but I didn't really think the preview had very good, great acting. This is a short preview, so it's hard to really tell. But I don't know. Maybe you should check it out. Adam can be a stickler when it comes to the civil rights movies.
Right. I mean, I won't. I'm harsh.
He's not giving good
grades
out.
I'm not going to give you. I don't give Bs unless you earn it.
Out of sympathy. So yeah.
Right. So great acting all around. I think.
Did they change Hound Dog's title to the Dakota Fanning rape movie? That's what I'm wondering, if they actually changed the title, because that's the only way it's referred to.
Yeah, I mean, you see Hound Dog, you have no idea what it's about. So, it did get a small theatrical release.
Yeah, I just wondered if they actually changed the title to the Dakota Fanning rape movie or not. I'm not sure on that.
Yeah, but it turns out that completely washed over.
All right, our next movie that we have coming up is a little bit different topic. It is the new teen comedy, Sex Drive.
Hey, what is going on with you? You bought rubbers? How did you know that?
It's on Russ Miller's blog.
Jesus, that was like 11 minutes ago.
What's the deal?
Dude!
She wants me to meet her tonight at the Big Boy in Knoxville.
You know, she doesn't want me, okay? She wants him.
I'm sorry. This is good. This is fine. I mean, that looks like you.
All right, Sex Drive. This is the new teen sex comedy from relatively unknowns, starring Clark Duke, who's famous from his Clark and Michael show with Michael Cera, as well as Josh Zuckerman, who you also saw there, who's a pretty kind of not well-known actor.
But completely unknown.
Well, he was in Feast. He was in Feast, which had a TV show, Project Greenlight.
Like I said,
he's somewhat known. Some people are fans of that. But this movie is kind of an homage to 80s teen sex movies like The Sure Thing and The Last American Teen Version. Even has some weird science moments with the brother Rex in there. And it kind of also blends in with kind of the late 90s American Pie, Euro Trip,
right,
which we talked about. This movie is surprisingly funny, and it's got some original humor that's not Apatow humor. It's more of towards the teen shtick. It's about a virgin trying, to lose his virginity over this weekend with a girl that he met over the internet. And so it's a great road trip movie. It's a lot of stuff that you've maybe seen before, but there's all new jokes. It has some great Amish jokes going on in here. Seth Green has a nice cameo in this. And I thought it was a really funny movie and surprisingly funny.
Right, I enjoy this a lot. Like, as you said, Euro Trip, the plot is pretty much exactly the same as Euro Trip. So no huge surprises there. But, comedies like these are all about the little bit scenes that they come up with and the little skits to do. And they were all very funny. I mean, it's obviously very raunchy. The 30 seconds we showed was pretty much the cleanest 30 seconds in the entire movie. But I really did enjoy this. I can't really explain any of the jokes that I enjoyed on the air, so it's kind of difficult.
Well,
James Marsden did a great job in his role.
Yeah, that was going to say.
Big brother.
James Marsden, who we'd seen recently in Enchanted.
Right.
In these roles that totally not like X-Men, this movie. Right. He completely plays this just arrogant jerk of a brother to the main character, Ian. And his name was Rex, and he's got this sweet 69, what was the car?
GT?
Yeah, GT, yeah, Judge GT. Yeah. Sweet, kind of looks like Dukes of Hazzard here, and he's very protective of it, and, he's very much anti-homosexual, gay basher, accusing his brother of being gay and all this, which that has a little plot twist in that part there, but,
right.
It's kind of like this immature, sophomoric humor, but I don't know, it really works, and the scenes with the Senior Donut is really funny.
Because I was sitting there, I was thinking, this is really the sort of stuff that you think of when you're that age.
Yeah.
It really gets into, if you're in high school, you're just going to love this movie. If you're a little bit older but still have a high school sense of humor,
like
then
myself,
you'll love it too, right?
Like myself, you still like this movie, even though you're way past those years, and you still like it. So.
Right, so not for the kids, but...
Yeah, there's a lot of sex talk, a lot of sex action in this. Some gross, some not so, but...
Rated R for Amish nudity.
Amish nudity, very much so. But yeah, it had some great bits in this, and I really liked... that concept of going on the road, and having fun with friends. Like you said, it was an Euro Trip, The Sure Thing, movie road trip.
It's been seen
a lot. But it was able to be original enough to, form its own niche.
I never sat there and thought, I've seen this before.
This is just
Even
like,
though I had, it still felt fresh.
Yeah, it did. Yeah. Somehow it still felt fresh, despite its homage to all these former movies.
Exactly.
And the guy that made it is pretty much unknown, too. So this is a brand new kind of generational... And unfortunately, it kind of bombed at the box office. So.
Yeah, I was really disappointed in
that.
I mean, you'd expect all these 16-year-olds to sneak into the movie and see it. Maybe that's what happened. Maybe it would have made a lot more money if we didn't have the MPAA rules. They would go and say, I'm going to see Secret
Life of Bees.
They
bought tickets for Secret Life of Bees. That's why it did so well. I guess the name Sex Drive kind of turns off the fundamentalists right there.
Yeah, I guess, Mom, can I go see Sex Drive? No. Mom, can I go see American Pie? You might be able
Road
to get
trip,
away with
it. That gets through with Sex Drive. No,
absolutely not. Going to work for
you. They kind of shot themselves in the foot there, but.
Well, a movie with a slightly different theme is Oliver Stone's W.
I see trees of green, red roses too, I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world, what a
All right, W follows the story of a young man named George from Texas who struggles with alcohol problems. And I don't want to spoil anything, but he goes on to bigger and, I don't want to say better things, but he goes on to make something of himself.
Yeah.
Obviously, this is directed by Oliver Stone, so when it was first announced, everyone's thinking, oh, great, another liberal hit job. And it turned out to be very fair to him. I thought it humanized him in a way that I haven't seen movies humanize major political figures, especially when we don't have a lot of historical distance on the issues that he's bringing up. I mean, the movie stops right around when the Iraq War looks sour. And you got Oliver Stone got most of his information from reports that have been put out, you know, Bob Woodward and some of the other reports by people. And so all the characters are pretty historically accurate. There's a fine line between doing an impression of somebody and being their character. And maybe, you know, Condoleezza Rice ended up being a character in the movie. But yeah, overall, most of the actors did a fantastic job. Josh Brolin was just incredible as George W. Bush.
You took the words right out of my mouth, Adam. That's exactly what I thought. Was Josh Brolin, I think, makes this movie. I mean, I think the important part of this movie is seeing that how Josh Brolin evolves into George W. Bush in this. And you really stop forgetting that it's Josh Brolin at some point in the movie. And you start thinking, oh, this is George W. Bush. And it's not that he looks identical to him. You know, there's been guys that look more like him. But his mannerisms and his, and, you know, the way he molds his face into the how Bush and, I mean, just the whole feel really succeeds in this movie. And he is fantastic. And I hope he gets a nomination for this. But my problem with this movie, though, is that I feel like this movie is, I mean, it already has a strike going against it because it's so fresh. Most everybody that's seeing this movie is very familiar with what's going on in today. And I don't really think this movie makes a point at the end. I don't think it really brings a perspective to the audience that I don't think it says anything in the end. Now, right. I think it would have been better if it would have been up to the point that he becomes president.
Right. I mean, I thought that too. I would have actually ended it at the point when Saddam's statue falls down.
That's where
I would have cut it off.
But
like, I agree with you. The whole movie, like when you see these biopics, it's all about how do we as America view this. When we see movies about Vietnam, they're a way to look at how Americans view the Vietnam War. With W, it doesn't really put a stamp. It doesn't summarize his life. So the whole thing is we have no idea what to make of him either, because you can't make him out the way that his presidency has gone. You know, I think even if you don't want to call it a fiasco, it hasn't gone very well, that you can't make it into this rags to riches, or I guess not, but drunkard to riches, Horatio Alger type story of overcoming adversity, because the ending, it doesn't end well. So you're like, how do we turn this
there
into
is
a
no
Hollywood
ending
narrative? You can't turn this into a traditional Hollywood narrative. And so Oliver Stone, I think, did a good job of presenting sort of this confusion. I mean, the very end scene is sort of a metaphor for more of how we view Bush than of how he views anything.
Right, yeah, and I think that is, I mean, like you said, I mean, this movie would have succeeded better if perhaps they didn't try to go after that ending. And, I mean, I think he's trying to go for that ending with the way the movie ends, and I don't want to... I mean, yeah. It's like, oh, became president. Whoops.
They should have gotten
it away.
They should have gotten with something ironic, like Charlie Wilson's War.
There is a kind of an ending to this that they're trying to make a statement, but I don't really think it really succeeds very well.
Yeah.
And I think ultimately that's where it fails. Nothing really happens. Like, you're waiting for, like, what are they going to say? You know, what's going to be the perspective? And that it never really comes.
It didn't change my mind about the presidency at all, and I don't think...
It won't change anybody's mind.
Yeah,
I don't think.
It didn't really present a view that everybody doesn't already hold.
Actually, I think the only thing, it may actually give him sympathy. I think people may actually feel maybe some more sympathy for him.
Yeah,
possibly.
The W haters will not like this movie. The W defenders will not like this movie. But most people will say, yeah, that makes sense.
I mean, I think it's more likely some people might be like, you know, maybe he wasn't such a bad guy. Maybe he isn't the devil incarnate.
He was
maybe
somebody
he's just this
just trying
moron
to do the
that's
right
kind
thing.
Of, old, that has power thirst, you know. And it turned out he maybe wasn't prepared for this.
Just in over his head a little bit.
Yeah, because, you know, maybe that'll change the people that are just think he's the devil incarnate and just think he's just kind of a moron. So I think that's the hope.
I think
that's what they're going for.
That's
the hope, at least. So.
Well, we will be back after a brief commercial break. We have a trivia question for you. How many Academy Awards has Charlie Chaplin been awarded? We'll put it that way. We won't say one. Think about it over the break. Answer may surprise you.
Is made possible by our friends at AMC Fiesta Square, where movies are just $4 every day and night, Monday through Thursday, and $4 before 4 o'clock on the weekends.
This is KXUA 88.3!
We'll be right back. Apparecciato la tavola? No, apparecciato la tavola. Letto un libro. Letto. Letto. No, 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 no.
Oh, it was such a heartwarming film about two brothers and a boy and his father.
But they really represent sort of the neo-existentialist way of thinking.
Entertainment, fashion, and Hollywood gossip. Tuesdays at 7 on UATV.
All right, well, the answer to the question is 3. Chaplin only won one competitive Academy Award. It wasn't even for directing or acting like you'd expect, but for best original music.
Yeah, and then 2 honoraries later. And, you know, some of that has to do with the fact that the bulk of his career happened before the Academy started recognizing and giving out Oscars, but there were still, you know.
Right, I mean, I think there were definitely at least a few years where he got robbed. You know, City Lights, Modern Times, and The Great Dictator were all in the Oscars.
And Limelight as well was right there, too.
And so it just goes to show that, you know, in retrospect, the Oscars don't make as much sense as you like to think.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of do-overs you'd want to do with some of the Academy Award winners.
So. I think Entertainment Weekly is trying to push that, too. But we're just going to take a brief look back in time 10 years ago to 1998, and we picked out 4 movies, maybe not the best, but they're just sort of a look at what people were watching 10 years ago. We'll start out with Pleasantville.
Yeah, and Pleasantville was a good representation of kind of like, it was kind of an original idea of taking, you know, the black and white and color that hadn't done in a long time, you know, and combining it and to do it with morality and different aspects.
Right.
And I know at the time in 1998 it was kind of a controversial movie because of some of the views that it took, and also we get to see Tobey Maguire pre Spider-Man.
Right, and one of his earlier roles, even, you know, pre Seabiscuit and cheese, pre everything, and you know he had
Reese Witherspoon
in there too. Yeah. Don Knotts making an appearance.
Yeah, one of the late Don Knotts appearances.
Right. I mean, I really enjoyed this. This is one of the 2 great dystopias that opened up that year in 98.
I think last year we actually had an argument whether this really was a dystopia.
Right, I remember that. I still think it definitely counts. I mean, it has all the same elements. You're going back to this oppressive society, and you have a couple rebels trying to break out, and even gets into the whole Garden of Eden motif that so many dystopias play off of as well. So I definitely think this counts.
I think it's probably a dystopia, but maybe just it's not your stereotypical dystopia by any means. It's complete. It's not sci-fi, you know, what we would consider sci-fi. But, you know, it's not a movie that I love, but it's definitely a movie that I appreciate and that I like. And there's some good performances in this. And it's some good ideas in this to look at. So Pleasantville was a good movie from 1998.
Right. And another favorite from 98 was Run, Lola, Run out of Germany. And this one I didn't enjoy as much as a lot of people did. It really hit the States big. The 98 was when, you know, a lot of people were first starting to get these cheap video cameras. A lot of young people, like myself included, were really starting to get into film. And for so many people I know, this was the first real foreign film that they'd ever seen.
Yeah, I really like this movie. And at the time, I remember thinking, yeah, I'm watching some foreign films.
Right, right.
Wow, this is great. It's like, I think the performance, though, from the actors, I think her name's Famke Potente.
I can't pronounce
or something
it.
Like
yeah.
that.
Ugh,
excuse our lack of German actors' knowledge. But she was really good in this. And, I mean, the whole concept of this, with this crime, you know, and the whole movie is she's running.
Right.
The title gives away the movie.
And it was really, it was so unconventional how they filmed it, too, because you'd have one possibility of how things would occur for about 10 minutes, and then you'd rewind, start back, and then she'd make a different choice and see how that plays out.
It was like a choose-your-own-adventure book.
Yeah,
I love
that's exactly what
books.
It was like.
And so that's what makes this good. I mean,
and it's one of the ones where you can cheat and keep your fingers in the pages.
You're like, oh, I wanted this one. I'm going to go back. Yeah. And this movie was perfect because it actually was put on celluloid, so you could see this and happen unfold in front of your eyes. But I think it was a cool concept movie, and it was a really cool crime movie. There's some there's some edge to this movie as well. It's not just I think it's rated R, but I don't know. It's a fun movie, and it kind of shows the aspect of the time of people trying to get into foreign films. Later would be Amelie would come out, I think, a year later after this.
Another popular film.
Yeah, that everybody was like, oh, I love foreign films. Right. I love Amelie, And it kind of went into this, mode that, and now I think more than ever we're starting to appreciate foreign films on a much mainstream and wider audience.
Right. I mean, it used to be like before this movie came out, before a lot of other ones in the 90s came out, then it'd be, oh, foreign film, ooh la la. But then you'll have, things like The Counterfeiters that came out this year, or you had, what was that one last year that won best foreign film, one from Germany? The Lies of Others. Just things like this will come out and people will just go see them. When you see like Kung Fu Hustle. Yeah. And so foreign films don't have the same, I guess, I don't want to say stigma, but same perception attached to it. So ordinary people who don't think of themselves as huge film nerds will still go see a film with subtitles on
it. Yeah, I think because of the originality of this, it really opened the broad. I remember when Il Postino came out in 96 and nobody gave a flip about going to see
exactly.
that. That did not, nobody cared about it. No one went, oh, I need to see that when it comes out on video or DVD. No one cared, but this movie, people were like, oh, that looks cool, so.
Right. Well, another one with an Arkansas native in it, we have A Simple Plan.
Yeah, A Simple Plan, Billy Bob Thornton, and Bill Paxton, and directed by Sam Raimi, who did the Evil Dead movies and went on to do the Spider-Man movies. And this was a movie he did just before the Spider-Man movies, which is about these two brothers that find this huge amount of money in this downed plane out in the middle of the snowy woods. And they go through this moral dilemma about whether to keep it, whether to tell somebody. And basically, it's about the inner turmoil that goes on within them, trying to decide what's the right thing to do, what's the wrong thing to do. And it kind of splits things apart. And it's a great psychological profile, I think, between these two brothers who care about each other, but it splits these brothers apart from, their friendship and their loyalty they have. And it's a really kind of dark, depressing movie, but it's excellent performances in this from both Bill Paxton and Billy Bob Thornton, who I really like. Maybe I don't like Billy Bob Thornton's movies, but I think he always is a solid performance, and he's usually a highlight. And he definitely is in this movie, which you saw him in those freaky-looking glasses that he has on going in there, and he's a very odd character in this. But this is a well-directed movie. Sam Raimi's a really good director, despite maybe your misgivings you have with the modern Spider-Man movies.
The first couple I really enjoyed the first couple Spider-Man movies. I haven't seen A Simple Plan, but like you said, both of the lead actors in it are very good.
Yeah.
So it'd be, this is something that I'll have to put on my list.
Yeah, I think it's definitely one that you should check. It's one that in 98, not many people, I think, really thought was going to be a great movie and checked out. And it's before Sam Raimi became mainstream with the Spider-Man movies, unless you were into the Evil Dead movies, you're in that kind of that niche. But right. Simple Plan's a really good movie, and it's really kind of a dark, fun.
Of course, in 98, you had the huge battle between Saving Private Ryan or Shakespeare in Love for Best Picture.
I'd
a lot of
Saving
people
Private
forget
Ryan, by the, way.
The Truman Show wasn't even nominated, which caused a huge controversy, mostly because this was Jim Carrey's first real serious movie.
Yeah, this was before he did. He started going serious with Man of the Moon and Majestic and stuff like that.
And so it's sort of, they don't want to give an award to somebody who, the quote, is broken to Hollywood by talking out of his butt.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think this should have been nominated. I don't love it that much. But it was directed by Peter Weir, who followed this movie up with Master and Commander.
Right. Dead Poets Society about a decade before The Truman Show.
Yeah, and he'd done Witness, and he'd done some really great films. And I think this movie should have been recognized, more than it was. At the time, it was kind of seen as this fluke. Oh, that could never happen. But we kind of moved into this Truman Show world with all the reality TV that's developed.
And that's the thing. Like, this really preceded the whole reality TV craze. I mean, you didn't have Survivor when The Truman Show came out. This was back in 1998.
Yeah, Survivor was 2 years away.
I mean, you had The Real World, but you didn't have... reality TV wasn't near as ubiquitous as it is now. The Truman Show, like you said, is... it's so believable now. I mean, I could conceive. I mean, you'd have a few child labor laws that you'd have to work around, but other than that,
I'm ready to sign up. I think the IMSOL show. I'm down with the IMSOL show. Let's go for it. But yeah, 98, like I said, there's lots, you know, you could say even better movies from 98, but we just kind of pick four selections here just to kind of give you an idea of what
something
was like,
that you should go
what
check
was going
out.
On 10 years ago. So
well, next week we have
High School Musical 3, which I know
yeah,
our
I'm
audience
excited
is,
for that. Just, Saw 5 as well, two fantastic sequels I'm looking forward to.
I'm actually looking forward to that a little bit.
And Pride and Glory is coming out.
That, yeah, we'll, that preview's we'll, I'm a little mixed on as
we'll
well.
Find out.
But, so next week may be a negative week.
But we
we'll
have
see.
A Halloween special. We're going to give you the best horror movies to rent before your week of Halloween, so definitely check us out.
And we got some killer costumes.
I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.
We'll see you next week.